casino. Unbelievable day. Trying to give some folks some time to get in here on Facebook Live. Of course, today on Sports Rush Daily, we're going to talk tons about this Kim Mulkey hire. Many calling it the biggest hire in LSU sports history. I don't think that from an athletic department standpoint, don't think that's an overstatement. We'll talk to Tommy Krysan, of course, who's joining us over at Tremonti's Meat and Seafood. Also, LSU Baseball. They won the series, but it doesn't feel like it, does it? After the epic collapse in Game 3 of that series, we'll break it down. Good and horrible when it comes to LSU baseball. They win a series, but somehow I come out of this weekend not feeling like anything's changed. But we'll tell you why that could be right or wrong. Plus a ton of Kim Mulkey stuff today. Press conference 5 o'clock. The public is invited. Don't go anywhere. We'll continue on with Sports Shorts Daily presented by LeBears right after this.
Every great story starts with the rush of thrilling gaming action. Handcrafted flavors, eager to please. Getaways for some well-deserved me time. And rewards worth bragging about. If it's a story worth telling, it starts at L'Auberge Baton Rouge. What's your story?
TK, I was told last Tuesday before the LSU-ULM baseball game that I did with Lynn Rollins on ESPN Plus, as I walked into Alex Box Stadium and saw some of the powers that be, I was told last Tuesday that it was a done deal, that Kim Mulkey was going to be the next head coach for LSU women's basketball. I was shocked and surprised. It took a while. It took till Sunday. You know, I was told Tuesday. It took till Sunday before it became official and LSU made the change. My understanding is that Kim Mulkey had a few little things that she kind of special requests and people she wanted to bring over from Baylor. And that took a little time to work through to make sure they dotted I's and crossed the T's with that, made sure a couple of the people got vetted and everything. And so that was the holdup. It would have, you know, it probably took a couple extra days longer before it would have been official. But they get it done. They land Kim Mulkey. I got a little nervous as the week went on, and I was still being told, yeah, it's a done deal. It's a done deal. It's a done deal by the people that were talking directly to her. But the fact that Nikki Fargus hadn't resigned, she was still on the Facebook page, hadn't signed the papers, it got a little weird. But at the end of the day, they got it done. And this is epic.
This is the greatest hire in the history of LSU sports, okay? When you look at her resume, when they hired Nick Saban, the resume didn't look anywhere close. It'd be akin to hiring Saban back tomorrow to do LSU football with the resume he has now. We've said it. It's going to be written. I mean, it's all over social media. She's a winner, okay? From Hammond High School, and, you know, start with Little League sports, Hammond High School all the way through from the Olympics to Baylor. She is a winner. Okay, she has made LSU women's basketball a topic again. It was a topic from 2004 to 2008 when they made the 5 straight runs to the Final Four. Hadn't been much of a topic since, okay? They're going to sell tickets. They're going to pack the PMAC without having to do a special promo. I think she can recruit. I think, you know, she's here to win a national championship. She's not here to do well in the SEC and try to get to the SEC tournament and try to make a run. She is a very competent person who has the resume to back it up. You know, Muhammad Ali was a confident person. He had the resume to back it up. She's got the resume. Now, it doesn't guarantee anything, but I promise you, you know, when Ed Orgeron got hired, I said, if he's not successful, it won't be because he didn't try. If Kim Mulkey's not successful in Baton Rouge, it won't be because she didn't try. I mean, I think if you're an LSU sports fan, you have to be fired up. If you're an LSU women's basketball fan, you better get some tickets now because they're going to be hard to get by the time we get to the fall. I think it's an amazing thing. And it knocked the baseball collapse off the top of the stories in Baton Rouge.
Paul Maneri probably wants to give Kim Mulkey a hug after that epic collapse.
That's smart. I don't know if you saw the video yet. The airport, she landed on the Taft plane, came out with the white jeans and the purple blazer and hugging Maneri and Will Wade and Scott Woodward. And I mean, this is, as you've told me earlier, press conferences at the Pete Maravich Assembly Center, open to the public. Okay.
Yeah.
Boom. You start thinking about this, and this really sends a message from Scott Woodward, I believe, that, you know, when he first got here, he said he's here to help people win championships. Well, he's now put LSU women's basketball on the map. Long way to go. You know, they had all the transfers, and it's not going to wave a magic wand and be overnight. But I would, you know, Ed Orgeron had the greatest football team in the history of college football a couple of years ago. Who knows? 2, 3, 4 years from now, she might have the greatest women's basketball team. And that's saying a lot with Tennessee and UConn and Stanford and, you know, the great women's programs that have existed and sustained over time. But, again, if you're an LSU fan, you better get your tickets now. It's going to be hard to get come November.
A couple of things here. One, Kim Mulkey, of course, from the Hammond area, from Tickfall, and you know, it's epic. It's well known that when she was 12 years old, you know, she was the first girl to play Little League Baseball in Hammond. When she was picked on the All-Star team that was playing a postseason tournament in Ponchatoula, the Little League commissioner decided enough was enough. They ruled she couldn't play in the game or sit in the dugout. This is back when Kim Mulkey was 12 years old. So we're talking 46 years ago, to 1974. Her dad hired a lawyer who got a temporary restraining order, but the Mulkeys withdrew it rather than put the eligibility of the other players in jeopardy when she was told she had to leave the bench before the game. A teary-eyed Kim watched the game from behind the dugout as her teammate dedicated the game to her and won it. Her quote at the time, she said, "I was embarrassed and real hurt. They made such a big deal of it. It was on television and in the newspaper. I didn't try out for the team to get attention. I just wanted to play." And then I think she went on to be like the first pick in the draft in her little league the next 2 years. So Kim Mulkey, second woman ever inducted into Louisiana Sports Hall of Fame, the youngest woman ever inducted into Louisiana Sports Hall of Fame. I believe she was 28 years old, Tommy, in 1990 when she was inducted into the Hall of Fame. The way the Hall of Fame works with Louisiana is you got to wait till 3 years after you're done playing professionally in order to be considered on the ballot. Well, there was no WNBA back then. And so when she went right into coaching after the Olympics in 84, her clock started. She wasn't trying to play any pro ball overseas or anything. So that's why she was able to get inducted so early. Craig Schilling says, his question was, is rebuilding the program her main reason for taking the job? Honestly, I don't know what her main reason is. I'm sure we'll learn a lot today at 5 o'clock at the press conference. Why would she leave Baylor, a program she's been at for 21 years, Tommy? 3 national championships, getting paid over $2 million a year. Why now, do you think?
I think she wants to win a national championship for LSU women's basketball. I mean, she did it at Louisiana Tech as a player and as an assistant coach. She's the only person in history to be a player, an assistant coach, and a head coach. Dean Smith and Bobby Knight also won national championships as players and coaches. We know enough about Kim Mulkey. You've interviewed her at the box a few years ago when her son Kramer was playing at LSU. And I'll say it. She's cocky. And maybe it's from when she was 12 and they made her get out the dugout. She might have said, I'm going to show y'all, you know. And she's a little vain, but that's okay. Great athletes, great coaches, they're all like that. You know, you can't find me a great athlete. Michael Jordan, he's cocky, great athlete. We can go down the coach list. Pat Summitt, one of the greatest women's coaches. Gino Auriemma. These people, they got that thread in their body of, I'll show you I can do it. And, you know, I think it's great for LSU. It's great for women's basketball in Louisiana. You know, she might do for women's basketball in Louisiana what Skip did for baseball, just raise the level from down to the Little League programs to all the way on up, you know. I mean, you know, when she was at Hammond High winning 4 straight championships, I was in Hammond at the time, and all, you know, they didn't, girls' little league sports wasn't big, but they all wore the double pigtail thing like Kim Mulkey did when they played. You know, she had that kind of an impact in the Hammond community when she won 4 straight championships in high school basketball. So, I mean, hey, it's going to be Mulkey Mania. They already got the T-shirts. I've seen them online already. I mean, it's a – a big, big time thing for women's basketball at LSU in Louisiana. And for a university that needed a big time good news story, they got one.
Giant news story and a good one, you know, with everything swirling around with the $50 million lawsuit and with Sharon Lewis and then the whole Title IX and the stuff with Darius Geis and the alleged stuff with Les Miles and everything. I mean, this is a nice distraction in a positive light. It's one, it's good for Title IX. It's good for LSU. If LSU must not be that bad of a place if Kim Mulkey left to take that job from a standpoint of as a woman. And, you know, she must be, comfortable with the current administration and the environment. It's all about how it's spun, right? And I think this is a good thing. We know in Louisiana some of the real stories of things, but sometimes from a national perspective, it takes a giant story like this. With the transfer portal, Tommy, I don't think we're going to have to wait long. I don't think we're going to wait long for this program to turn around and become a winning program again. I expect them probably to be in the NCAA tournament next year because, again, with that transfer portal and the way things are nowadays, you know, she can go get her five players right now.
Well, that's what she brings the complete package to the table. She can recruit. I'm sure she can raise money. And she can coach. Let's not forget that, okay? She can coach. She was an assistant at Louisiana Tech when they were winning tons of games, an assistant when they won a national title, went over to Baylor, won three national championships at Baylor, okay, at Baylor in a 21-year window when you had Tennessee and UConn just dominating the women's game. She found a way to break through. So, it's the complete package. You know, we always say, Ronnie, when somebody makes a big hire, well, we got to wait and see. We have to wait and see, but I think we will see. I really believe that. Look, I had three people over the weekend tell me they're going to a women's basketball game. They love sports. They love LSU, or they just like seeing great things. They're going to go to LSU basketball games this year because of the statement that's being made by Kim Mulkey. And look, I heard one of the little things was she wants to have a higher recruiting budget. She needs a higher recruiting budget. And tip your hat to Scott Woodward. He got her here. She's here. It's done. It's official. Press her at 5 today. If you're open to the public, you got to do all the social distancing stuff at the PMAC. And it's going to be a fun ride for LSU women's basketball. And quite frankly, I'm looking forward to it.
Looking forward to it, Tommy. I haven't been to an LSU women's basketball game in a number of years. I went to a Sweet 16 game when they lost to Penn State, I believe it was, or were going to the Sweet 16. Maybe it was six years ago or something, 5-6 years ago at least, the last time I went to a women's basketball game. But unless there's something crazy coming up, I'm sure I'll be at the first one this year when Kim Mulkey comes, and I'm sure it'll be sold out.
I'm going to request a press pass. All right, Ronnie, the little Kim Mulkey story you don't know about.
All right.
Myself and a friend, he had a date with her. I had a date with someone, Jock Mel Inn in Hammond, many, many years ago.
Good spot.
Now, she would not remember, okay? Right. She would not. Well, she would remember who she went with. And I don't want to say his name on the air. I'll tell you off the air, or you might already know.
Yeah.
He's a public figure, so I don't want to say his name on the air today. But we were doing nothing wrong. But it was a fun night. She was great to be around that night. We went from Jock Mellon to the Brown Door to drink some cold beers. So, yeah, that's what you do in Hammond back in that time, you know. So,
Kim, most famously Kramer Robertson's mom. I'm so glad that now maybe she'll be Kramer Robertson's will be Kim Mulkey's son, right? If he makes the big leagues, But I think, Tommy, that I know I lost a $100 bet on this deal. Casey McKenzie, I got to owe him $100 because I never thought they were going to hire Kim Mulkey. We had this conversation weeks ago, and I thought, one, it's a terrible time for LSU financially, right? They're facing a deficit from the COVID year, the lawsuit, everything that's going on right now. You might have a coaching change in baseball. I mean, there's all kinds of things going on. I didn't think they were going to step up to the level that they did. But TAF was able to find some boosters that were like, hey, whatever it takes, get it done.
I was incorrect also. I think I said here on Sports Shorts Daily, I didn't think it would happen. I do recall a private conversation with a good friend when I said, it's not going to happen, and here's why. And some of the reasons you had delivered, I said, Ronnie had some good points. So, so I was incorrect as well. But like you, couple of days ago. I knew this was going to happen. I even texted you Saturday that it'd be a press conference Monday because I'd gotten the full word on that that's when it was and all that good stuff. So, you know, hey, again, tip your hat to Scott Woodward, to LSU, and I'm sure she's ready to go to work and, you know, start doing things to help LSU women win basketball games.
Craig, to be straight, yes, we know she's Kramer's mom, but if Kramer makes the big leagues, they'll start saying her son is Kramer Robertson, as opposed to saying Kim Mulkey, the mom of Kramer. They'll be saying Kramer Robertson is the son of Kim Mulkey if he becomes a big leaguer, which he's got a real good chance to do. What do you think that this does for Will Wade? With everything, the cloud that's over Will Wade a little bit right now, does this have an effect on him in any way, the Kim Mulkey hire?
I think it helps him. I mean, he had his purple plaid coat on today, hugging her at the airport. I think it helps him because maybe he can, you know, and I don't mean this in a condescending way, maybe he can learn from her. I mean, her pedigree is what it is. You know, maybe they sit down at lunch one day and, you know, they brainstorm a topic or two. Maybe he sees how she does things. Maybe she can tell him, hey, here's a little tip that helps with recruiting. I think it helps Will. It can't hurt. And it helps the entire athletic department to have someone of this stature become a part of it. Because there are times when they all meet together, not often, but there are times. Or I'm sure if there's another coach in the athletic department or whatever sport, hey, Kim, can we meet next week, Thursday, 2 o'clock? And, if she can make it happen, she would. But to answer your question, I think it helps Will Wade, and it helps bring attention to basketball at LSU on the women's side, which, you know, can spill over to the men's side. We've seen programs in this country, Duke many years ago, both the men and the women went to the Final Four. You know, we've seen UConn had some good basketball alongside the women. So we've seen it happen where – it just raises everything up. And I think it's going to help the whole athletic department.
I do think it helps Will Wade from a standpoint of the media. You know, maybe it softens it a little bit. Maybe they focus more on Kim Mulkey. Maybe it's just less attention to a certain degree on him. I don't know that it's going to have any impact with the NCAA on what it decides to do or not do. But as far as, like, his day in, day out, you know, whether it's print media, whether it's social media, whether it's radio – maybe less conversation about Will Wade and more conversation about the positive in Kim Mulkey and LSU's women's basketball program.
Yeah, well, like we said, it knocked off LSU baseball collapse off the Baton Rouge headlines, certainly. And you and I hadn't forgotten. I got a lot of text messages, a lot of conversation at the ballpark yesterday I was at about the LSU baseball thing. But, hey, tip your hat to Scott Woodward, to the LSU athletic department. National news, it's all over everywhere. And I mean, it's, you know, the old saying in Hollywood, I don't care what you say about me, just say something. Well, LSU is getting talked about finally in a positive mode after, you know, a couple of months of not so positive.
And look, I was explained and told by some of the TAF board members how this thing's going to work out positively for LSU financially. Sure, they're going to sell more season tickets. They'll sell more corporate sponsorships. They can probably get to a point where they can justify to a certain degree the money. Albeit LSU baseball will have more season ticket holders than LSU women's basketball. Just a little tidbit there. And Paul Mineri don't make that kind of money. But she will be a tremendous fundraiser on the circuit. She'll be somebody that'll, you know, go on the road with them on their Tiger tours and their private meetings, and donors will give because of Kim Mulkey. She's 58 years old, probably has about a 10-year window before she decides to hang it up, if not a little less, but, you know, say 10, and she'll be able to make it work. Let's talk a little LSU baseball, Tommy. Tigers take 2 out of 3. That's great. That's a positive. They're 6-12. They went on the road and beat Ole Miss, although Ole Miss has lost 4 series in a row, so they weren't beating the Yankees. But they did go on, and they were beating an Ole Miss team that didn't have its best hitter and its best pitcher this weekend. But still, they went on the road, and for 25 innings, they were the best team all weekend in Oxford. But the 9-1 collapse, where they trailed by led by 8 runs, and they wound up losing the game on Sunday, was such an epic defeat, Tommy, that it almost feels like LSU lost the series, doesn't it?
It feels like it to me. You know, Ronnie, we've talked many times on Sports Shores Daily, you know, when you got that two-run lead in the eighth and ninth, you got to win that one. Because there are going to be days when you lose in baseball. All championship baseball teams suffered losses. But when you got an eight-run lead in the eighth, you can't let that get away. And, you know, I want to tip my hat again to A.J. Labus. What a job Friday to go throw a complete game, keep everybody in a bullpen, get the win on the road, and it was a tight game until very late. And then now, you know, people don't even remember how great Labus was. Marshall did fine. Labus was the player of the weekend for LSU. And then to just have it come apart like that, I mean, that's crushing. And you got number one ranked Arkansas coming to Baton Rouge this week. I mean, you know, Coach Menard, you got to put freshmen out there. Fontenot couldn't throw a pitch. I mean, you know, he didn't throw Friday. I mean, I don't know, man. It's just, you know, so many fans are frustrated with decisions. The double steal Thursday. You know, I mean, Bianco made the base running blunder, not Paul Maneri on Friday. But just some of the other things and the decision of when to put a pitcher in, when to take a pitcher out. Fans are frustrated, Ronnie. And like you said, you just took two out of three from a ranked team on the road in the SEC. And people feel like the weekend was, you know, a negative.
A couple of things, Tommy. First off, positively, all right, before I get negative. And that is that LSU's up to number 22 in the latest RPI in Monday's updated official rankings. That's five spots up from 27. LSU currently ranked number one in the country in strength of schedule. So through the first 10 weeks, they've had the toughest schedule of anybody in the country according to the numbers. LSU is number three in the nation in home runs. They've got 55. Arkansas, who they play this week, is number one. They've got 72. Old Dominion is in second place with 62. All right, that's the positive. Also, A.J. Labus, agree with you. Career performance, complete game on the road. Devin Fontenot finally showed up and looked like the stud that we thought he was going to be from game one this year. Devin Fontenot was a beast out of the bullpen. LSU hit over 300 for the weekend. A lot of great things. Cruz came up with a big hit, you know, when he really hasn't been clutch. That great average. Morgan continues to torch the baseball. Looks like DiGiacomo's back healthy, doing some things. A lot of good things. Okay, here's the head-scratcher negatives. Why did Drew Bianco start every game this weekend? Where the hell did that come from?
Okay, I'll say this. Okay, go ahead. Finish, and then I'll comment.
You got a guy in Zach Arnold who was drafted out of high school, who you thought good enough of to start the year at shortstop, which means that he's, you know, at second base, he's the best option you have at second base. Cranford's not going to hit his way out of a wet paper bag, so that's not an option. You now have Zach Arnold. Just put the dude in the freaking lineup and let him go. He was slumping, and he's hitting 250. Drew Bianco, they throw a party for if he hit 250. We're excited that he's just now hitting 200 after he got three or four hits this weekend. I mean – just if I've got a guy, Tommy, that's hitting 50 to 100 points higher than another guy, it's a no-brainer. By the way, Zach Arnold was almost hitting 300 a couple of weeks ago. Who's got more of an upside, Zach Arnold or Drew Bianco? It's not even close. I don't understand it. I get it if you want to give him a courtesy start against a lefty on the road at his daddy's place and say righty-lefty, and we want to – but to start all three games, like, that just came out of nowhere.
Well, and – if he started because Mike Bianco's the head coach in the other dugout,
why
that's
else would he
100
know?
Million times wrong. I can't say anything, but that's dead wrong. That's embarrassing, okay? And, I mean, Drew Bianco's not a college baseball player. He was in a transfer portal in the fall. Guess what? Nobody else wanted him. He came back to LSU. I mean, Ronnie, he played in one of your tournaments many summers ago at U-High. And I was doing the PA work for you, and I told you then, that guy can't play college baseball. Because every now and then, you know, we get one right. And, I mean, but when I saw him in a lineup Friday, I was a little bit surprised. And then, like you, Saturday, Sunday, the guy can't hit. You know, they had that bases loader in that sixth inning of one game. Him and Milazzo struck out. Where are the pinch hitters? You can't send a guy up that can't hit in that thing against an SEC team. Let him play against Grambling tomorrow, you know? I mean, it's just it's mind-boggling.
It's weird, and listen, great kid. There's a place for him to play somewhere at another level somewhere. If he wants to play at LSU, he's got to be utility backup. He has the ability to play center, has the ability to play in the infield spots. and every once in a while runs into a ball. If you ever throw Drew Bianco anything other than a breaking ball, you're a fool. So I give his dad credit. He wanted his kid to have some success. He mixed in a couple of fastballs and gave him a chance, and he was able to get a couple of base hits. I mean, it's
college baseball.
He swings and misses at breaking balls as if he's blind. And it's no disrespect. It's okay. It's okay. He just needs to be somewhere else, or he needs to accept his role as a backup. But the fact that Pulmonary is trying to put this round peg into a square hole with Drew Bianco is just unbelievable to me, Tommy. Like, I know he respects his dad and likes his dad. Mike's one of the two coaches in the league he likes. But this was just – Zach Arnold's going to leave, no question. And I hope you're okay about it. I mean, I'm sure Paul's going to spin it and say he's got some other kids coming in, because Zach Arnold's got to be like, what in the hell is going on? Why am I not playing? Why are you shoving this Collier Cranford and Drew Bianco crap down our throat when I'm the best option you have?
Ronnie, okay, started Thursday, we all went, what? He started Friday, we went, what? Well, when he made the worst base running mistake I've seen in a long time, when he tagged from first to go to second on the fly to right. Right then and there, Zach Arnold should have been inserted, and Bianco should have been done for the weekend.
Of course.
For making such a selfish move that, you know, the team overcame it and won the game, but it was a selfish move that almost cost his team the game. And for him to not be disciplined, by discipline, I mean taken out of the game, put on the bench for that. Oh, well, that's because his daddy's the other coach. Somebody just commented on the thing. We got high-level daddy ball going on.
it's bizarre to me. It's clear that there is some sort of special treatment that he gets that the other players don't get. It just is. Because you're right, Tommy. The minute that Drew Bianco tagged up at first and got thrown out at second in that situation, he should have been pulled for the game. I'd have done it if it was the Baton Rouge White Sox or whoever. Because that was a situation where he is so desperate to make something happen. I said this on Sports Short Saturday morning, or maybe even Friday. I don't know. When was that? Was it Thursday that it happened?
Friday was the ball.
It was a Friday game. So I must have said it on Sports Short Radio Saturday morning. He's so desperate, Drew is, to make something happen positively, because he's had such a bad year and just not a great career. And so he's trying to, you know, he wants to hit a homer every time he comes up. He wants to make the great play as opposed to just taking the walk or making the basic routine play. So he's and then not to mention you throw in on the road at Ole Miss in front of his friends and family and his dad, and he's adrenalized and a big crowd, and he's just so desperate to make something happen that there's no common sense, no baseball HWA that comes to mind. And so he just runs right into an inning out to prevent a run, because he's just so out of his mind to make it happen.
And it may have been Thursday. I'm trying to recollect again. The Kim Mulkey story took precedence. For him to remain in the game, it's like sometimes in college football, I see these players, like the guy that threw the shoe for Florida against LSU, they didn't even take him out of the game. Ronnie, if that would have happened when you were at Menard High, I mean, that guy would have been – he'd have been – in the parking lot somewhere. So same thing with Mulkey. Take the guy out. That's inexcusable. That happens in coach pitch, you know, when a little kid doesn't know what he's doing and they're still trying to have fun and learn the game. I mean, that was really, really bad. HWA, look at Harry Barrios chiming in. I love it.
How to win awareness, baby. How to win awareness. All right, so here's the last thing before we sign off today on Sports Shorts.
And I got one thing before, yeah.
On the epic collapse on Sunday, on the third game of the series, Saturday, on the epic collapse in that series, LSU had a 9-1 lead. But let me go back to before they had a 9-1 lead, Tommy. The score was 6-1 going into the fourth. Will Helmers pitched the first three innings. Why did they pull him?
I can't.
He had a low
that,
pitch
Ron.
Count. He's got a 6-1 lead. Yeah, it wasn't pretty. It was, you know, he hit a guy in the third and he got doubled. I mean, it wasn't pretty, but he had a 6-1 lead after three innings with a low pitch count. We're trying to find a third starter. We know it's not Blake Money from his two previous bad outings. We're trying to – Helmers is going to be a dude this year and next year. He is a dude. He's 5-1, 6-1, whatever his record is. Why did they pull Will Helmers, first off?
Well, I can't answer that, but that goes back to – something that has been talked about with Paul Mulkey for many years. He never he He has an issue with when to pull a guy, when to leave a guy in. It ain't necessarily who he puts in. It's when he makes the switch or doesn't make the switch. And that's another case. I mean, let the guy throw it. I mean, he's in shape. We're late April, you know.
So next, he puts Blake Money in, who is good enough to start the last two Sundays in the SEC. He puts him in. He goes an inning and two thirds. It's the bottom of the fifth. LSU's now up 9-1. Blake Money's in the game, one of your better relievers, and a freshman stud who's going to be a dude for years to come. He's pitched an inning and two thirds. The score is 9-1. Hasn't given up a run. He has a runner on base. Palmieri pulls him, brings in Javon Coleman. Why did he pull Blake Money? Why does Blake Money not pitch more than an inning and two thirds in a 9-1 game when we still have four and a third innings to go in the game? He's a dude for you. He's throwing well. What? Yeah, he gave up some loud outs, but again, why do we pull Blake Money? Okay, so then he puts in Javon Coleman. First off, he costs Blake Money a win. Blake Money would have gotten the win. One more out, he was pitching in the fifth. So he wanted to get Javon Coleman a win? I mean, it's so stupid. So anyway, he brings in Javon Coleman. Okay, Javon Coleman gets the out. Congratulations. Now we move to the sixth. Javon Coleman gives up no runs in the sixth. Not a clean sixth. It's a little funky. If you don't swing at Javon Coleman, you're probably going to walk. I mean, because, if you just took to your head two strikes, he's going to walk every other guy. All right? Because he's a young freshman, hard-throwing lefty. That's what lefties do, right? Go to the seventh. Javon Coleman loads the bases with no outs. Somehow pulls a Houdini trick and doesn't give up any runs. So now we're going to the eighth with a 9-1 lead. Javon Coleman, the freshman lefty, who by the grace of God hasn't given up a run in two and a third innings, making his first ever SEC appearance ever on the road in front of 10,000 at Ole Miss. He's now going two and a third innings and hasn't given up a run. We should pat him on the back, tell him great job, way to go. You're going to be a dude for us moving forward this year and next year. Let that dude ride home on the bus feeling good about himself. Let his mom and dad post all kind of wonderful things on social media all week. And next week against Arkansas, he's a guy now coming out of the bullpen for an inning or two. We had the quick hook on Helmers with a 6-1 lead after three innings. We had a quick hook on Money after an inning and two-thirds scoreless. But we're not going to have the quick hook on the homeschool kid from Texas who's making his SEC debut as a true freshman. That's the guy that we're going to extend who in the sixth and seventh inning pulled a Houdini magic trick to not give up a run. Okay, so now we get to the eighth. They leave him out there to give up six runs, to give up six of the eight runs. They leave him out there. And look, I have no problem with Edwards and Floyd, but you bring in Edwards, he hits a guy, gives up a homer. Floyd comes in, gets the out, and in the bottom of the ninth gives up a homer in the first pitch. By the way, the homers that Ole Miss hit, the homers that Ole Miss hit on Friday, I mean, was a true freshman that hit the grand slam to tie it. And in the ninth, it was a true freshman that hit the home run to win it. It's just unbelievable. It was, and look, we got Craig jumping in here saying that, pregame Coach Maneri said on the radio his plans to go with Helmers for three and then go with multiple arms variety to keep Ole Miss off balance, stuck with plan and didn't go with what was happening on the field. Absolutely. You can go in there with a plan all day long, but I guarantee you Paul Maneri didn't think they were going to be up 6-1 after three innings. Okay, and then also, who told him that he had to pull? Freaking Money? I mean, like, listen, I'm all for getting the lefty Javon Coleman some innings because I think the dude is going to be a stud, Tommy. But let Money go four innings or three innings. Let's bring in Coleman to throw the seventh, maybe the seventh and the eighth. And then let's get Floyd the ninth or Edwards or get Coleman the seventh and Edwards the eighth and Floyd the ninth. But we don't extend Helmers. We yank Money too early. But with the guy with the least amount of experience of anybody in our bullpen, who's the homeschool kid who hasn't pitched in an SEC game, we're going to let him have the rope to hang himself with. Inexcusable. It was terrible. I don't know what to say. They're 6-12, Tommy. That's the good news. They got to win 7 of their next 12 games to give themselves any chance of getting into the NCAA tournament, because that would get them to 13 wins. And I do think with that record, strength of schedule, the way the SEC has looked at, 13 could possibly do it this year.
Ronnie, I agree with you 100% with everything you've said. I think it's all fair questions. And I know a lot of people watch this know this, but, you know, I respect your baseball knowledge. You've been there, done that. I've got a lot of knowledge from been there, done that. And I think people watching this know that. And you're spot on. Very fair and very reasonable questions and all of that good stuff. I mean, I just don't – it's mind-boggling, because it shouldn't get to that point. You know, every coach has made a bad decision. It's like every – batter struck out. Everybody makes mistakes, okay? But from Coach Maneri, when it comes to pitching and putting them in, taking them out, it's been that cloud that just never went away.
You know, Tommy, it's a tough Monday, you know, for us here. But we're so glad that Kim is our new coach here at LSU. Tommy, tell us about what's going on over Tremonti's Meat and Seafood, and stop talking about LSU baseball.
They got chicken fried steak for lunch today. Always got the lunch special. They kicked up the whiskey selection and the wine selection. Hey, Mother's Day, a couple weeks away. Want to do the crawfish boil thing for Mother's Day? You got to book it. Connect with Tremonti's Meat and Seafood on Facebook and Instagram, or stop by here on Jefferson Highway, right down the street from Parkview Baptist School and Church. You got the Chairman's Reserve beef. I mean, they got the ribeye rolls, the shrimp rolls, and they'll have crawfish ready every day this week, about 3:30 or so. Saturday's about noon. And many of you have been here. We appreciate that. If you haven't, stop by Tremonti's and just take a couple of minutes to look around, see how many things and all the stuff that they have here at Tremonti's Meat and Seafood. Mike's on it out on a catering job for lunch right now. He just left a minute or two ago and gave me the thumbs up. So we want you to check out Tremonti's, and for that Mother's Day in a couple of weeks, whatever else is going on in your world, you'll be glad you did.
Before we go, let's tell you one last time about the Louisiana Sports Hall of Fame Golf Classic. It's coming up next Monday, a week from today, at Latour Golf Club down in Matthews, Louisiana. That's right there next to Thibodeau. It's a beautiful David Toms designed golf course. And the night before, we have a big pre-party over at Flanagan's Restaurant, right in the shadows of Nichols State's football stadium. Great event, $25,000 putting contest, thanks to the folks over at NOLA Lending Mortgage Company. And thanks to Latour Golf Course for sponsoring our event. If you like more info, go to lasportshall.com. Go to lasportshall.com. DM me, whatever. You can get tickets to the party, get tickets to the golf tournament. You can be a sponsor, whatever you like. We got that coming up. It'll be a lot of fun. We'll talk. We'll have a lot of celebrities down there.
Hey, don't forget, I'll be back here at Tremonti's Thursday. I'll be at Court Street Cafe in Port Allen Friday. A little schedule change this week. And Ronnie, I can jump ahead a little bit. We're going to have a schedule change or two next week with the great golf tournament you guys are putting on for the Sports Hall of Fame. So, hey, folks, you know how to do it. Like, share, follow us on social media, connect. Many of you got our phone numbers. We'll keep you posted, but we appreciate you letting everybody know about it. A lot of feedback, Ryan, this weekend out at the ballpark. People really rocking and loving Sports Shorts Daily. So, you know, great way to keep up with us, and like and share it. That's a key that helps Ronnie and I, and it helps Tremonti's and LeBears and Baker Brinton and the Hall of Fame and all the Court Street Cafe. It helps everybody when you like and share this. So we appreciate it.
By the way, we'll talk a lot more LSU baseball today on Hanging with Hanny. I'll be on with him from the Brulee Walk-Ons. That'll be from 12 to 3 on ESPN Radio in Baton Rouge.
One thing real quick. We got to do this Thursday. Bumgarner throws a no-hitter. Major League Baseball says it's not a no-hitter.
Because it was 7 innings and not 9.
Scrap everybody else's stats, too. We'll talk about that Thursday.
All right.